Sunday morning. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 147. David writes, "Praise the Lord! How good it is to sing praises to our God! How pleasant and fitting to praise our God! The Lord builds up Jerusalem. The Lord gathers the exiles. And the Lord heals the brokenhearted. And the Lord binds the wounds of the injured. The Lord determines the numbers of the stars in the skies and calls them each by name. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. Our Lord's understanding has no limits." Today we have come to praise our great God, our Creator who knows each of us personally, and whose power and care and love for us has no limits. Would you pray with me this morning? O Lord, we trust in your power to create and to sustain and to enable. We know that you are always near to each of us. Be with us, Lord, as we gather in our homes and in our church to worship you today. Calm our hearts and our minds. Open our eyes and our ears that we might experience your holy presence and life-changing truth. This we ask in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. This morning we are blessed to have with us Mark Jones, who's going to come and lead us in worship as we lift our eyes to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
children's chat this morning, I want to remind our children that we are talking about being kingdom builders. And we have learned that being a kingdom builder, helping to build God's kingdom here on earth, means that we need to be encouragers, that we need to have holy vision looking for God's blessings, that we need to be a people of prayer. And one of the prayers that teaches us a great deal about how to be kingdom builders is a prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, the Lord's Prayer. And so I want to invite those of you at home this morning with your children to join me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Part of this that we're going to focus in on today is that if we are going to be God's kingdom builders, we have to be our-centered and not I or me-centered. You'll notice in the prayer, it doesn't say, my Father who art in heaven, or give us this day my daily bread. It says our. One of the first things that Jesus tells us that we need to do if we're going to be kingdom builders is we need to realize that we are part of a community, that we are God's child, and that God is the father of people in Iraq, and God is the father of people here in North Carolina, and God is the father of people in Israel and all over the world. And so when we pray, and when we encourage, and when we are looking with our holy vision, we want to remember that we are doing all those things as part of a community, and that we are praying for all of God's children throughout our world. So this week, I want to encourage you to be our kind of people, not me or I. To not just pray for what you want, but to pray for what other people around you might need or want. To remember as you're praying that you are praying not just to your God, but to the God of our world. Let's pray together this morning. Gracious Lord, as we come to our pastoral prayer time this morning, we draw comfort from the reminder that you are our Father. And just as the psalmist said, you know all the stars in the sky by name, that you know each of us by name as well. You know the burdens that are heavy on each of our hearts this morning. You know the losses that we have experienced. You know the challenges that we are facing. You know the questions and the uncertainties and the anxieties that are keeping us awake at night. And Father, we draw comfort from the knowledge that not only do you know these things, but at this very moment in time, your Holy Spirit is at work in a way that is going to work things together for your good, your purpose in our lives. And so we pray that you would help us today to rest in that promise, that you work to get all things together for the good of those who trust and wait upon your direction. And so we pray that you would help us to trust and wait today. We pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ. We pray for our family members and our loved ones that also need to wait. upon your timing. Give them peace. Give them grace. And whisper, I love you in their lives today in a way that they feel and see and experience. We ask this in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It's a joy to be with you this morning. It's a joy to let the folks at home know that we got a few more folks here in the pews this morning, and that's good as we start the new year off, if you will, in the church calendar. We know that Advent comes a little later in the year, starts off the Christian year. We know that the new year on the calendar begins in January. But oftentimes the Sunday after Labor Day is when we begin to get things cranking in the life of the church, and that's where we are today. And this weekend, we know that things are getting a little bit more, normal may be wrong, but at least we're getting a few things back. College football played a few games yesterday, and the NFL will play a few today, and we're beginning to see some of the things that bring excitement. And of course, the season started for my Seminoles as it ended last year with a loss. So things must be getting a little bit more normal, right? Well, I'm excited this morning as we get back into worship to dive back in at the beginning of Scripture. For several years now, I have used the narrative lectionary. The Scriptures that are chosen weekly in this compilation start at the beginning, just after Labor Day, in Genesis, and take us through all of the Scripture in 9 months, weaving together the story of God's love for you and me. And so we're back to Genesis, and you may say, well, why do we go back to the stuff we've already known? And with virtual school, I have this conversation just about every day with my kids. Why are we doing this again? I already know that. I've done it before. And we go back and talk about practicing the fundamentals. Why does somebody that plays in the NFL in the NBA practice dribbling every day? Why do they practice shooting every day? Why do they run the drills and lift the weights and do the little things? Because that's how we build into the core of who we are those most important truths. And so today we come back to Genesis chapter 2 as we look at breath and dirt, the two most important ingredients in life. Breath and dirt, the two most important ingredients in life. Hear now the word of the Lord in Genesis 2, verses 5 through 7. It says, at that time, God made earth and heaven, before any grasses or shrubs had sprouted from the ground. God hadn't yet sent rain on earth, nor was there anyone around to work the ground. The whole earth was watered by underground springs, and God formed humans out of dirt from the ground and blew into the human's nostrils the breath of life. And he came alive, a living soul. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now I want to ask you, have you ever eaten anything that only had two ingredients? Started thinking about that because these two ingredients today, dirt and breath, are what you and I are made from. But I began to realize that some of my favorite foods, my favorite combinations, my favorite meals are made with two ingredients, peanut butter and jelly. Milk and cookies or cereal, okay, whatever, you think through it. What are the two key ingredients of pound cake that give it a name? A pound of butter and a pound of sugar. That's how you know it's healthy, right? It's good stuff. Two ingredients. And I went online and there are web pages of recipes where you can make meals with two ingredients. One was peanut butter banana ice cream, frozen bananas and peanut butter. And you stick them together somehow. I didn't read too much about that. No dairy needed. sounded good to me. Two simple ingredients. Flour and water mixed together can almost make what? Yeah, biscuits, bread, something, right? It doesn't take much, and in Genesis 2, it says that you and I are made with two key ingredients, dirt and breath. Dirt and breath. And I believe those two ingredients are absolutely critical for us to understand who we are and who God is and who we are in relationship to God and to one another. So help me out a little bit. In my family growing up, there has always been a debate, a critical debate, and I'm glad my folks are here today because they're the ones that debate about this. What is the color of dirt? What is the color of dirt? My dad, who was born and reared in Illinois and spent summers on the farm in Iowa, will tell you that dirt is, what color, Dad?
Black.
Black. Dirt is black. It's a black, rich, deep, dark soil that you work together and plant in, and from that soil comes the produce of life. And my mother, who was born in North Georgia near Chattanooga, Tennessee, will tell you that the color of dirt is what, Mom?
Red.
Red. Red clay. And I saw that this weekend as I traveled. Had a chance to drive up to see Kate in the mountains, and we were near Lake Glenville, and around Lake Glenville on the shore that's a sandy soil on the North Carolina side of the state line. As we drove home down through South Carolina, we crossed a bridge over a tributary going into a lake, and as you looked down at that lake, around that lake, when you looked at the soil, it wasn't sandy tan, it was red all around the lake there in South Carolina. What color is dirt? You ever thought about that? Does it really matter? See, here's the thing. Depends on where you come from, doesn't it? The dirt of the ground is different colors depending on where you come from. And it says here, at the time that God made the earth, before there was grasses or shrubs, He reached down into the Adama, in the Hebrew, the dirt, and He created the Adam, the human. God reached into the Adama, the dirt, and He created the Adam, the human. Adam isn't really a name. You hadn't heard that before, sorry to spoil it. Adam became a name, but it's the Hebrew word for human. And God reaches into the Adama to create the Adam, and He reminds you and me that we're all made out of what? Dirt. Now that doesn't sound real sexy. Hey, you dirt ball, right? That's what we could call each other. And it goes on to tell us that from dirt you were created, and to dirt you shall return. You see, we're created with two ingredients, and that first one I think is so critical. I think knowing that we're created out of dirt informs us about how we interact with each other. Why do I say that? Well, first and foremost, it comes down to this color of dirt. Is dirt black or red or orange or tan? What color is the dirt from which we're made? And I'm here to tell you that I don't think it matters. It just matters to know that God reached into the dirt and formed you and me. Not just you and me, but everybody. Out of the dirt from the area in which they came, God says, I don't care if it's black dirt or tan dirt or red dirt or whatever color dirt. I have created all of humanity, and I hold humanity in my hands, all of them. When you and I begin to interact with one another, sometimes it's easy to look to other people and say, well, you're not like me. But Genesis and the creation story reminds us that we're all like each other. We're all created out of what?
Dirt.
None of us better than the other. All colors and types from all places. Created in the hands of God. Why is it important to know that you and I are created out of dirt? Well, I think in knowing that we're dirt, we're reminded that we really don't have much reason to get on our high horse, do we? I am just a mud ball created out of the mud and dirt that I spend so much time trying to keep off my shoes and out of my fingernails and off the stuff of my life. You and I are made from the dirt. We are Adam, created out of the Adama, all of us. I believe knowing that we're made of the dirt humbles us, reminds us that we are creation, not the creator. We are created, and because of that, there is one greater than any of us. God. For it is God who starts the process. God is above all and before all and beyond all. And it is God who creates all. You and I are made of two ingredients, and the first one is dirt. And dirt, Adama, it's that stuff from the earth, and it should remind us that none are better than the other. The other thing that Genesis 2 says is he made the Adam out of the Adama in order to work the Adama. He made the human out of the dirt in order to go back and work the ground from which the human was created. We're supposed to be in touch with the dirt. Now, why is that important? Well, we live in a world of hand sanitizer, and I'm all for it in a COVID environment. But what we're finding is kids are healthier when they play in the what? Dirt. We need the dirt. We need to get dirty. We need to be in touch with the land. We need to care for the creation that came from God's hands and from which we come. We are called to work the dirt, to get dirty, to be in touch with the land. And I believe that calls us to creation care as well. Why? Because it is from the dirt that God created that we come, and we are called to work that land and to care for it, not to dump Gen X into it, not to create a mess of the creation that we were given and from whence we come. Knowing that we are made from the dirt should humble us and charge us to connect with it and with one another. Knowing that you are dirt isn't supposed to make you feel bad about yourself, but rather connected to one another. We are all little mud balls. But there's a second ingredient that changes things. For you and I can create mud balls and make little Gumby type figures if we want to. How many of you have made mud pies before? As kids, we love to create and play in the mud and the dirt. It's part of who we are as God's creations from the dirt, and we make stuff out of that. And you know, you can take certain kinds of mud and clay and make almost little snowmen out of it, right? Little balls. But they don't do anything. Why? Because they're only made of one ingredient, the Adama, the dirt. And they sit there, and we can play with it and move it and do all that, but we don't have the second key ingredient which brings them to life. Listen to how it's recorded in Genesis 2. It says, God formed humanity out of the dirt from the ground and blew into the human's nostrils the breath of life. And the human came alive, a living soul. The second ingredient that you and I are made of is the breath of God. Now in Genesis chapter 1, at the end, it says, we are made in the image of God. Imago Dei. In each one of us is the image of God. And so when you look at each other and we hear this, that we're just dirt, yes, that is part of who we are, but the second part of who we are is that we are made with the breath of God. You've heard the song Breath of Heaven before. It talks about we cry out that the breath of heaven would breathe into us and give us new life. In the New Testament, Paul tells us if anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come, a new creation. God breathes into us life. You and I are made from dirt, and that should humble us. But we're also made from the very breath of God. And the word breath comes on to have the same translation as wind and spirit. And God breathes into you and me and gives life. We're humbled that we're dirt, but we ought to be lifted up, that we are made in the very breath of God. What does that mean for you? If the breath of God, the wind of God, the Spirit of God is what fills you and gives you life, then you and I, as creations of God, are wholly filled with that breath. The question that I ask of you today is, when you look in the mirror, what do you see? What do you see when you look in the mirror? You see, if you only see one of these ingredients, then your whole identity is messed up. If you look in the mirror and only see dirt, then you don't realize that you carry within you the very image and breath of God. And I would call you to look in the mirror again and seek to find that. For we need both ingredients. But some of us look in the mirror and we see the image of God. And we forget that we're dirt. And we feel like we're mightier than others because we see the image of God in us more than we see it in other people. And we need to go back and look again and see the dirt in ourselves and be reminded that we're all connected as that creation, pulled from the dirt of the earth, the Adama, to make the Adam. If we are to have a right perspective of who we are and whose we are, if we have the right perspective of relationships with one another, we need to understand both ingredients, dirt and breath. So today, I ask you, which one do you need to see? Do you need to look more and see the breath of God in you to understand that you are filled with Spirit of God that was blown into you at creation, and now that you're called to take into the world, that you are unique and special? Or do you need to be reminded that you, like me, are common, ordinary, and created out of the dirt? You see, we're both of those things, and when we look at others, we need to remember that they're both of those things. No better or worse than us, created from the same dirt, but also infused with the breath of God. Whether they were created with red dirt, or tan dirt, or black dirt, they, like we, are the creation of the hands of God and the breath of God, called to be the children of God in the world. Now, what does this look like in its total fulfillment? I believe that dirt and breath give us a picture of what God desires from us and for us, and what we see in His ultimate fulfillment in walking the earth in the form of Jesus. Fully God and fully human. Filled with the breath of heaven, but made of flesh that was made from the dirt of the earth. What does it look like to be the person that God created you to be? Well, we look at the person of Jesus, the fully balanced one who was both divine and human and calls us to live that out in doing the two simple things that he says encompass the entire law. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love the one who breathed life into you. And love your neighbor as yourself. For maybe, just maybe, you were created out of the same dirt pile. Breath and dirt. It's what we are. It informs who we are. And it ought to cause us to look at ourselves and the world a little differently. Will you pray with me? God, we thank you that we are both common and unique. We thank you, O Lord, that we are made of the dirt and called to get dirty, for it's so much fun to splash in the mud puddles and to not have to worry about keeping ourselves too clean. But we thank you that we're more than a ball of mud, that you've breathed deeply into us so that we might breathe deeply of you in the midst of the difficult days. Fill us with your breath, O Lord, that we might be alive, and humble us to know that without your breath, we are but the dirt beneath our feet. May the ingredients from which we're made change our perspective of ourselves and others, that we might see our connection to you and our neighbor, and thus to love more deeply both. This we pray in the name of the one who came and walked in the dirt of the earth, fully human as he was born of humanity, but fully divine, even Jesus our Lord. Amen and amen. As we go today, I want to remind you that we'll be back for our Bible study on Wednesday night on Facebook Live as we continue to dig into 1 John, but I also want to ask you to pray especially for several families in our congregation who are grieving and who are seeking God's guidance as they plan treatments for medical care and others. We're not going to share their names this morning, but we do ask that you just lift up those folks in need. Know that people around you may be hurting in deeper ways than you could imagine. And so I just ask that you would ask God to bring comfort and peace, hope and love, and even joy in the midst of difficult days. Go in peace. Amen and amen.